11 o'clock. I'm supposed to start talking to you guys. Fine.
My apologies. And turn my
thought. How's everyone this morning?
Good.
I don't know why I'm wasting time putting my thoughts here. So, this talk is going to be about how I got sued by a faith healer. That shouldn't have happened. And I swear this is going to be on the skirt. It's going to take the skirt off. No, that's going to be good. So, I was sued by a faith healer in 2015. And I'm going to tell you that story from the beginning. If it'll work. I should turn this on. All right, so this starts with David Somalia. If you guys are familiar with Dogma Debate, if you're not, you should go check it out. David Somalia is the host and founder of Dogma Debate. And he was the person who originally sent me the first video of the faith healer known as Adam Miller. That's David. I know he's dark, but that's how he is. And David had this thought. He goes, you know, Stephanie will pose, dude. She sent me this video. So we did. This is the faith healer. Oh, shit. That's my slide. Hold on. There we go. Faith healer. Not professional. Sorry. That was my bad. Let's go to slide a little bit. That's him. That's the jerk that sued me. And he sued me for defamation of character, tortious interference, and copyright infringement, which will end to.
What was that? Okay, I can just hear you part of the
Like right here?
Yeah.
I will speak into my shoulder. So Adam Miller was a faith healer. I say was, we'll get to that later. From Brisbane, Arizona. And he had a website called adamhealer.com. Adam-healer.com. Don't try to go to it, it's down. I played a small role in that, I think. And he didn't like the fact that I went after him. He doesn't understand that if you put something on the internet, people have a chance to respond.
We're hearing your voice.
Yes.
And an echo is from the mic.
Ah.
You're speaking to the mic. We hear mostly from the mic.
Lights off. Yeah, this is why. It's because I'm wearing clothes that aren't necessarily super productive, which is fine. I guess I'll get naked later. So this is the first video I made about Adam Miller. If you can't see it, I pasted what's his face? Hatch Adam's face on his face, which he took a huge exception to. It was where he got the defamation part. This slide is where he got the entire justification for his defamation suit. Well, that and the next one you see. In this video, he explains how he uses the Holy Spirit to come break up, and I quote, dark cellular energy to cure things. And so I was like, wow, that's really cool. Too bad this isn't in hospitals. Let's see why. I went to his website and found out absolutely that it was nonsense. But remember, now this guy's bald, and he was claiming to cure baldness. I have nothing else about him as far as that goes. So let's skip ahead. 5 months later, really, it took him 5 months to realize that I had made a response video. It was brilliant. And this is a mirror, actually, because he took his original video down. In this video, where he says, responses to the personal attacks and fraudulent accusations, despite the fact that all my accusations came from pointing out things that he said on his own website, and saying, ha, ha, you're wrong. No, that's not how anything works. He also decided to dead name me, so he doxed me in this video, use my birth name. And he ensured that all the people that he interviewed for this, most of them, were nice and transphobic. It was super wonderful, people telling me that I was confused about being a girl. Okay, moving on. This is probably the easiest, this is probably the best way to illustrate that video. These are his 3 points. You can't tell me my magic powers are bullshit. You're just a stupid tranny, and I'm going to sue you really hard. That was his entire point. He really wanted to sue me. And so I made a response to that video. He's a crybaby. I'm such a but so mean. And then he then updated his website, believe it or not, to take down all the stuff. But he reformatted it so that it didn't come off as you tell me that you can cure cancer in children by waving your hands over them, I may have a problem with you. After I made these two videos and some back and forth with him personally, and his wife and his minions, they're cute people, I made a video called Go Ahead and Sue Me.
Yeah.
If anyone in here has ever watched South Park, this is from an episode where they went going after Scientology. Now at the end of the episode, there's a speech that Stan gives talking about how Scientology is awful, that's wrong, how it's a scam, etc. Every mention of Scientology, I spliced in Adam from this video saying his own name. So things came out like, you can't make fun of Adam Miller, kid. We're going to sue your ass and your balls. That's fine. Go for it. I thought he was kidding. It was a joke. I didn't think he would actually do it. Apparently, I'm just a troll. And the lawsuit comes. This is the actual, these are the actual service papers. Now, I redacted my birth name because he filed it under my birth name despite the fact that in 2014, my name was legally changed to that. I was also curious why he called me a Colorado resident when he was serving me in Maryland. But hey, you know, private investigators can fuck up sometimes, right? Then, all of the news hit. Friendly Atheist did a story, as did JT Everhart, which was picked up then by my foundation, or not mine, but rather the one I work for, Richard Dawkins. It was also showing up on the Daily Dot. It showed up on Tector. Ended up on Salon, Christian Post of all places, and Ross Story. Also, he's not here, but Penn Sunday School also did a thing on this and helped me raise some money for my defense. Speaking of my defense, I think my lawyer's here. And if he would stand up and take a round of applause, that would be fantastic. Thank you, Mark. Mark was my lawyer for this particular suit.
Oh, glad.
Mark was the lawyer for my suit. He was so gracious to simply look for a way to raise on GoFundMe. Very nice man. Very good lawyer, too. We had a lot of fun with this dude, to say the least. He kept lashing out, and we finally got sick of it. The funny thing about his little attempt to censor me is that it caused what's known as a Streisand effect. Have you heard of the Streisand effect?
Yeah.
This is fun, isn't it? All right. So Adam Miller wanted to shut me up. That was his cause. What happened is I got louder and more annoying and more trollish. The purpose of the suit was to get me to take my videos down, right? To censor me, so I wouldn't have to ruin his business anymore. His attempt to sentence me failed because I was simply telling the truth about him. It wasn't making erroneous claims about his character. I was just saying, yeah, you can't heal cancer in kids. You can't cure baldness, bald man. Sorry. He used my being trans against me, which is, of course, an incompetent attack, which sparked most of the anger against him, hilariously enough. Most of the people that supported me were like, wow, this guy's really mean to you. I was like, yeah. Isn't that weird how I said you don't have magic powers and you have really angry? Doesn't that tell you something about his claims? The settlement. This was Mark's idea, and I love him for it entirely. I can't take credit for any of this. He's brilliant. So we got on the phone and decided that, well, not we decided, his lawyers called us and said we want to settle. It's weird for a plaintiff to call a defendant and say, well, so. I think it may have something to do with this stuff happening all over the place on the internet. So maybe he got a little gun shy.
Okay.
Yeah?
Not your lawyer told you. You understood your
advice. I understood my lawyer to say.
You understood. Thank you. Your advice.
We worked together on a thing and gave me input. Let's put it that way. But he had some good ideas along the way, and let me tell you how we settled this, because they were asking so much for me to settle, and they, part of the settlement is they wanted me to take down the videos. So I said, fine, donate $25,000 to Opportunity Village here in Las Vegas, drop the lawsuit, and do all of this by May 20th at 5 p.m. Incidentally, I just want to point out that the only condition for me taking out my videos was this donation. All he had to do was give $25,000, which he clearly had, right? Because he went after. He hired lawyers to come after someone that wasn't big at all on YouTube for no reason. This didn't happen. The only things that happened were that he dropped the suit by May 20th, which was a great phone call. Although I do have to say I was a little disappointed when I didn't get to go to court, because that would have been fun. Adam, what's your case? Well, I have magic powers, and this person said I didn't have any. Okay, Adam? We're going to bring in this amputee, and I want you to grow their limbs back. Doesn't work that way. Oh, go on. So that's why I was looking for it, but it didn't end up happening. Ah, I didn't fix this. Oh, well. It's just AKA quote. Shut down his website completely. So if you go to adamhealer.com, it should say, page cannot be found. He did then start faithwarrior.com. I can't get over this. It's funny because there's an entire page about me being an internet bully. A whole page dedicated to me about what a jerk I am. It's long. You gotta read it. So I'm not gonna put it up here. It's too much. If you go to faithwarrior.com, you should go read that because it's hilarious. There's also a lot of typos. He's selling his home in Arizona, I found out. So that's good news, ruining his life. The website being down is helpful because it limits his ability to affect people, right? Everyone has a computer, everyone has a smartphone. So if people can't find him on the internet to perform this pseudoscientific nonsense, I feel like I did a little bit of good getting him off the scene and making sure he can't hurt anybody else. Some of the people that I listened to were really desperate, you know? And this dude, I really don't like medical pseudoscience because it harms people the most, I feel like. He threatened a second lawsuit, incidentally. So I said, Mark, would you mind giving his lawyers a call to see maybe if they could shut him up for 5 minutes? It turns out that his lawyers didn't want to work with him anymore, or whatever their story was. He said he's not a client of ours anymore, so that's interesting. Why? They, of course, didn't answer that, but I have a feeling that it's because he was in pain. Because he would say stuff to me privately, if he would send it to the lawyers, like, you might want to shut him up, because this is getting bad for you guys. Like, he said all sorts of nasty stuff to me in private messages. But then more media got the attention that he was going to file again, and backed off. It's amazing what the media will do for you, liberally biased as it is. In fact, this whole thing was pretty good to me, so I'm glad I won. Yeah, so they dropped with the comments. The moral of this story, if there is a moral to this story, is you shouldn't be afraid to call someone out. Don't use that hominins. Only use that stuff against them. And you're more or less bulletproof. Now, I'm not a lawyer, so don't sue me for saying that. But, I mean, my channel doesn't have that many subscribers and blew up because of him. The whole reason I'm even giving this talk is because of that. So, yeah, I appreciate you making me that sort of. I don't consider myself, or I didn't at the time, consider myself an activist for skepticism. I was just doing YouTube videos about why GMOs are fine and chiropractic is nonsense and things like that. Until I saw this video, actually. This actually made me far more activist than I already was. The activism I did wasn't necessarily against things, it was for stuff, but now I have to be against people like Adam and those kind of things. What you guys can do is, as skeptics, never letting that stuff slide. Now, I don't mean literally never. Like, if you're at a party and someone wants you to see their chakras spin, let them do it. It's fine. Or, if someone asks you their sign, and you say, hey, what's your sign? You say, oh, I'm a Tyrannosaurus. And they're like, that's not a real zodiac sign. And you go, none of the zodiac signs are real. Sorry. It's just calling out skepticism every day, because like I said, it took 5 months for this guy to find me. 5 months. I made this little video just about how he was wrong. And that turned out to be a huge success because I didn't back down. I didn't see a lawsuit freak out. We as a community, I thank all you guys for helping me win this suit. Because if not for you, I wouldn't have been able to pay for Mark. If not for you, I wouldn't have had the support. So this victory is more to the entire skeptic community, because they're the ones that funded me. I simply called him out on his BS. But, like I said, you guys really helped me. And so know that if you do go after someone, and it's legitimate, and you're not necessarily mean about it, in the sense you're not using your helmet, the likelihood is everyone in this room and everyone in this conference will be behind you and then some, going after these people. They need to be stopped, because government isn't going to do it, consumer relations isn't going to do it, so we have to take it upon ourselves to go after these charlatans. They're everywhere. There's chiropractors in every city. There's psychics in every city. Go after them. Please. Please go after them. That means doing secret recordings of what they're saying and calling them out. If that means doing a video, if it means writing a blog, please, please call them out. And as long as, like I said, as long as you're truthful, there shouldn't be an issue. I don't think I'm courageous. People to know you're so courageous for doing this. I don't think so. I think I'm just being a proper skeptic. I really think I'm just doing what skeptics are supposed to do, just call out nonsense. Now, you can be a skeptic of a lot of things and not have a passion for any particular thing. So just write about critical thinking in general. Do something to advance critical thinking, please. I only have one YouTube channel. There's not that many skeptics around, so we need to make more of them, and let's make more skeptics. Will you do that with me? Can we make more skeptics? Fabulous. I'm going to turn this over to Susan, who is waiting for me to shut up, and so she can get to her part, and then we're going to close it up after that. Thank you.
Everybody. How many people here, besides I give you a little business card, knew what GSOW was or something about the project? Okay, thanks. Okay, so that's a pretty good show. Yeah, it's about half the room. So in this room, do most people know what Wikipedia is and generally kind of, okay. You'd be surprised at what I hear sometimes when I give these lectures. So, my name is Susan Gerbick, and I will be your speaker, myself and the Armadillo, for the next few minutes. And I will be speaking about skeptic activism. This is my newest logo, Gorilla Skeptics. We are just playing off the word Gorilla Skeptics. We spell it many different ways. What I'm going to talk to you about today is the We Got Your Wiki Back project. This is activism on a large scale. As Stephanie said, it's really important that we call people out on their nonsense. But there's a lot of people in this world that aren't confrontational. They don't want to go up to somebody and do what she did. That was very brave to be able to go and sue someone and, you know, and handle the negativity, the comments and being called out and the lawsuit and the stress. That must be really, really awful. What I do is a little more cowardly. I'm at home in my pajamas with a cat and I'm making changes on Wikipedia and this does have a huge outreach. As Stephanie said, we need to make sure that we're making more skeptics. We know that people go to Wikipedia to get their information. We know this for many different ways that I'm not going to go into at this moment. We know that even if you don't directly go to a Wikipedia page to get your information, you're probably getting information about Wikipedia from the blogs you read, from the media that you ingest, the opinions of people around you. You're getting your Wikipedia information somehow. We know many times that bloggers and reporters will copy and paste the article from Wikipedia. You can still see the little citation numbers that don't go to anything, but it'll just be in the article for some random thing, and you're like, you just took that from Wikipedia. So one of the things that we are really more famous for is this project called the We Got Your Wiki Back. And what this is what we're trying to do is obviously improve Wikipedia overall so that people get the best content possible. We really only focus on scientific skepticism, science topics, pseudoscience topics. We don't necessarily look at science topics that are more like a like the symbol of chloroform, and you know how we don't do that kind of thing, but we will work on the Wikipedia page, possibly the person who invented who discovered chloroform or something like that. So the We Got Your Wiki Back project is where we are trying to make sure that the people that we're writing that are your spokespeople, the Ron Lindsay's over here, the Paul Offit's, the different people who are out there doing the work, the people who are getting the anti-GMO people after them, the people who are getting the negativity, all those horrible things that are happening to these people, we need to have their backs. That's how I feel, because they're representing us. They're the ones that are getting doxxed. They're the ones that are getting, you know, letters written to their workplace. They're the ones that are getting threatened and sued and so on. So we need to have their backs. And the best way we can do that is to have them have their best foot forward. And by having an awesome Wikipedia page, it says so much about that person. It says so much about our organizations. It says so much about how we care about what we're doing and who represents us. And we need to make sure that those pages are in great shape. Photos, audio, and all kinds of different things. Because this is where the media is going to get their information, and this is where the public is going to get their information. Anytime our spokespeople are in the media's eye, they're going here. And I'm going to show you this in a minute. So when I did this lecture, kind of, this is a new lecture for me, my editor said, my team asked me to include a couple things. And one of them they wanted me to include is a before page. This is Robert Todd Carroll. I've written a lot about him recently because he's recently died, and he was a friend and contemporary of mine and a peer. Miss him a lot. He just recently died in August. And Robert Todd Carroll is known for creating the Skeptics Dictionary, which is Wikipedia before Wikipedia. Just incredible project. I mean, he gets millions of views still, the website's still up. So I took this picture of Bob Carroll at Skeptical. Woohoo, Skeptical! I invite you all to Skeptical in California. And I took this picture of Bob Carroll at one of the first lectures I ever gave several years ago, 2011, on GSOW. And this is the Wikipedia page. I don't expect you to read it, but this is the Wikipedia page that represented him. And you can see there's 10 citations. And that's really a pretty good Wikipedia page for a person in our community. This is actually very good because we weren't really taking this on. This wasn't something we were doing. But once we got involved, and one of my editors, lives in Egypt, a young editor, he finished his training and I asked him, you have to do a Wikipedia rewrite. You have to rewrite a Wikipedia page. And he picked Bob Carroll's because he was so inspired by Bob Carroll. In fact, he got to write to him just and tell him how much Bob Carroll meant to him right before Bob Carroll died. So it was really, really great. And Bob was just like, oh my gosh, there's somebody in Egypt that is writing about, that cares about Skeptic Dictionary and cares about what we're doing. And I mean, you can get killed in Egypt and some of these other countries for the things that he, you know, that we're doing, he's reading. So this is Bob Carroll's Wikipedia page until, I think it was May or June. And then this is the Wikipedia page now. Again, I don't expect you to read it. You can look it up on your phones. We have all this, everybody has their phones. But now you can see that there are 53 citations. This man has the legacy that he has, and it can grow, we can change it as we go. But this is showing Bob Carroll with some respect, and we really do owe this man and a lot of the people that we're writing about some great respect, and we want to have this person represented well. So when the media is going, who's this Bob Carroll person? They can go to the Wikipedia page and find out a lot more about him. Okay, So here's the story I'm going to tell you. I have lots of stories to tell you, but I'm only going to tell you one story today. Now, whether you know what cupping therapy is or not, it's not important to this story, but I'm going to explain cupping therapy to you from the GSOW perspective. Now, you may or may not have known that the Olympics were going on, but back in the summer, there is this thing called the Olympics, and the swim team, the U.S. swim team, has been known for quite a few, let's say, wooey kind of placebo kind of things in the past, and they've changed from, I think, power balance bracelets to the little strips that go in your nose, and the media picked up this story. The New York Times picked up this story about Michael Phelps, and he was appearing with these big red hickeys, perfectly circular, all over his body. Everybody kind of remember the story hitting the media. Okay, what happens is it gets picked up in the media, and then we start sharing it on our social media. And that's great, we're sharing it with our friends and family, fantastic. But we're not getting beyond the choir. We're not getting beyond our community. We're getting to each other going, yeah, hi, man, that guy's ridiculous, that's so stupid, you know. But it's not getting out where it should be. So the New York Times picked it up. Here, CNN picked it up. And then CBS News and all these other things. And I'm at home. I was about to go to work. I'm retired now, 3 weeks, thank you very much. And I'm about to go to work. I have 30 minutes. I'm looking at the clock going, oh my gosh, what in the world is the media is writing about this, but what are they seeing? Where are they getting their information? They were calling in cupping people to be on the TV shows to get their information about what cupping is. What do you think they're saying?
Yeah,
it works, you know? So I thought, oh my gosh, I need to find out what the heck is going on. So I went to Wikipedia. Remember, I've got 30 minutes. And here's what I found. This is the lead. You can't read it. It's a little tiny print. Don't worry about it. This is the lead. And what generally people do when they go to Wikipedia is they read the lead and they're off because they just want to know what the heck it is and they're out of here. So in a nutshell, they read that and said, cupping therapy is an ancient form of therapy and it promotes healing. Okay, I'm out of here, I got things to do. And this is the photo that they saw. And that's kind of an icky photo. I mean, the woman's got a light lip flame next to her hair and, you know, it doesn't look very sanitary and, you know, it doesn't look very clinical. But anyway, this is what they were seeing. But if we narrow it down to even a bigger nutshell of what people were seeing, is they said, cupping is old and it works and they're out of here. That's all I know, right? They could read the whole page and find out a lot more information about cupping, but they're not really going to do that unless you're really interested in this topic or you're writing an essay or something about it. So enter the We Got Your Wiki Back project. So the We Got Your Wiki Back project is something that, as we talked about, we should have the spokespeople's pages already in great shape. So again, like I said, I have 30 minutes. I went and called up different pages that I know that we have rewritten, and it's August 7th, and I said, all right, what in the heck has Harriet Hall written about this? We wrote a Wikipedia page for Harriet Hall, so I know her page is in awesome shape. So I pull it up, I put in cupping therapy, she's done an article on cupping therapy. And I pull up another one, David Gorski, we also wrote his Wikipedia page. Stephen Novella. We rewrote Stephen Novella's page and actually translated it to several different languages. Because GSOW works in all languages because it's far too important. We cannot ignore that there are other languages besides English. So then I went and I pulled up a few more pages. I'm like, Edward Ernst and Mark Crispin and Simon Singh and David Calhoun. These are all pages that are coming up that we've worked on. These Wikipedia pages are strong, really great Wikipedia pages. What did they write about cupping therapy? Very few people are probably going to read their Wikipedia, I mean their articles. Again, it's mostly our choir, people who are already there, they understand science-based medicine, they already follow this thing, but we need to get them in the place where they're really going to get some information. And you know where that is, Wikipedia, right? So what I did, and I don't expect you to really read this part either, but I put in a very quick lead. I changed the lead to say this, and everywhere you see that it's blue is a hyperlink that a person could click on and go to that page. And critics of alternative medicine such as Harriet Hall, Mark Crispin, Simon Singh, and Edward Ernst call cupping pseudoscience nonsense, a celebrity fad, gibberish, and state that there's no evidence that cupping works any better than a placebo. Pharmacologist David Calhoun writes that cupping is laughable and utterly implausible. Cite. So I've got all that on there. This isn't the most elegant thing to do. I probably just slapped it on there and had to get to work, right? So then a few minutes later, just before I'm out the door, David Gorski puts up an article, and I added in there too. It's all risk for no benefit, has no place in modern medicine, another citation. And then I'm out the door. So I'm a portrait photographer by trade, 34 years, specialized in children and families and mostly little toddlers and things like that. Photos are extremely important to getting the story across. You guys would agree? So there was a photo going around the internet. Now, when you're going to put a picture up on Wikipedia, we cannot take a photo and put it up. It has to be correctly licensed. I cannot just do what the media does, which is grab a photo. The licensing is insane to get that to be correct. So I came home from work and I'm like, okay, I want to make this happen. So I took a photo off of a Chinese video that is really horrific. It is the extreme of what cupping really does. It is like the really bad. So I have a blank screen here because I'm going to show you the photograph. I filled out the licensing as best I could. I know I didn't quite do it right. I really hate doing the licensing legalese stuff. I have people on my team who do that well. But I'm going to show you the photo, and it's just really disgusting. So just in case you don't want to look at it, just look away. I'll have it off in a couple seconds. Yeah, see, it's a little early morning for you, right? Okay, this is extreme, extreme. But I'm thinking to myself, let's get a photo on here that visualizes what harm you can have from cupping. Now, this guy really blew it. He was having himself cupped over and over in the same spot. When the blisters came up, he had them popped. And, okay, picture's gone. Okay, maybe it's on the left. Sorry. But imagine you are the world looking at Wikipedia at that moment, and you're going, what's this cupping stuff? Oh, the U.S. Olympic team does it. Cool. Well, considering they're only going to read that little bit of lead, and they're going to look at that photo, maybe that would have a few people going, oh, maybe I don't want to do this. That looks pretty bad, right? Okay, so I don't speak many other languages other than some English and Spanish. And I went in and I added that same photo to every one of these language pages. I have no idea most of these languages are. I just opened the page, hit paste, and added it in, save, and I was out of there. So this is all happening within about a 20-hour time. This is August 7th. I got out of work early because I was retired, so I was able to do that. Then I come home, and there's one more thing that happened. Brad McKay, who's an Australian and a New Zealander doctor that we've sort of been working on his Wikipedia page, he put up this article about cupping and about the Olympics, and he said that it's a disservice to the fans that follow their lead. It's ancient but useless traditional therapy. So this is all in the lead, right? Then, I also told my team, please go and edit the Wikipedia pages in the languages you speak, the Chinese, the German, the French, the Dutch, and let's get the leads at least changed in all these other languages, because we know people are gonna go, they're watching the Olympics all over the world, and they're gonna look at those pages. So then here's what happened, a feeding frenzy. This is what happens on Wikipedia when the media finally pays attention to Wikipedia and the people who are the editors. They descend on the page, and it is insane, because you can't make an edit stick, because you've got editors editing, changing, no way to reword it like this. So I and my team completely backed off. We went on and did something completely different and just let it go. The editors come in, and the editors, the rules of Wikipedia are skeptic rules. You must have a citation. You cannot use words that are opinion, unless it's opinion of somebody like Mark Crispin or Harry Hall. And you're quoting them. All the rules are skeptic rules, and we need to own this because this is our thing. Wikipedia is made for us. This is really where we need to be. So we backed off completely, absolutely ran away from this page while the rest of Wikipedia descended on it. This is now about August 9th, 8th, something like that. That's when people finally started doing it. And then the page got rewritten. The lead changed again, and here's what it says now. if you were to sum it up, cupping therapy is pseudoscience, it does not work, and it may be harmful. That's basically what's on the page now. It's a little more wordy than that. I think it's two sentences. And here's a couple photos. They added another photo. They took mine down. Within 20 hours, my photo was not correctly licensed. But this is what it looks like now, which is, you know, it's not the greatest. So we like stats, right? We're skeptics. We want to know, did this work? What the heck, you know? So I need to tell you, we can look at stats on how many people view a Wikipedia page. We cannot tell how long they're on the Wikipedia page. We can't tell if they're a unique viewer. We can only tell if the page has been accessed. So remember, this is all happening at the height of the media's attention. And the Wikipedia page for cupping was getting about 1,200 views a day before the Olympic team hit. Oh, wow, that's teeny tiny. You can't even see that. So, oops, no. Don't look at that, So, okay, sorry. If you were to see that, the big spike is 106,000 views in one day. And that's the day that I'm on it. So it went from 106,000 views to 60,000 views to 50,000 views to 40,000 views, and it's been maintaining at about 1,500 views a day. So it was 1,200 views normally, now we're at about 1,500 views. So this is what has happened. The media hit it, and people went all over the world going, what is cupping therapy? And they found that photo, and they found that lead. And that's what we wanted them to see. And then I obviously haven't shown the slides on the big screen before, so this one I don't think you're going to be able to see. But that's okay. We'll make it up. So the We Got You Wiki Back project, for the 20 hours or so that I had all those people's names in the lead, you know, the Mark Crispin and the Harriet Hall, they eventually got moved to the body of the article. That's where you'll find them now. Somebody just moved it. Said, these are really great opinions. These are really great stuff. Let's just move it down to the body, which is probably where it should have been. But remember, I didn't have the time to go and rewrite the Wikipedia article before I went to work. But this is what happened to these editors. I mean, this is what happened to our people who had their name in the lead for those 20 hours time. You can't see it. Oh, I'm so sorry. I apologize. But everybody had the same spike, exactly the same huge spike. It was not 100,000 views. It was more like 500 views, and then went down to 400 views and 300 views and so on. So everybody saw that same exact spike, because that means that people read the lead, clicked on the person's name, and went and released access to their Wikipedia page. Now, if GSOW had been on it and had the Wikipedia page for cupping therapy done now, and let's say the Olympics were happening right now, what probably would have happened is the media, ABC, CBS, CNN, would have accessed the Wikipedia page because they don't know what it is, and they would have seen the names of our experts in our community. And they probably would have contacted the Harriet Halls and the Mark Crispins and the David Calhouns and the Brad McKays, because they would have gone to their Wikipedia pages and said, this person has some great credentials and some nice photos, and look how well written they have. They obviously are a respectable scientist who knows their stuff, and look at all these great articles they've written. So the media might have likely accessed our people, but because we didn't know cupping therapy was going to be a thing, I didn't have a page already written. Now, when the next celebrity fad comes up and the cupping hits again, we can probably see that this is going to, you know, so possibly our people are going to get more and more hits because of it. So I'm going to show you one more thing, and this just happened a couple days ago. I don't know if you saw this all over your social media. Actually, this is a model, and her name is Katie May, and she died 8 months ago or something like that. And on Science Blog, ORAC, which is David Gorski, wrote about the fact that she had some accident at her modeling thing, and she put it up on Twitter that her neck was really bothering her, and she hurt herself, so she was going to go to her chiropractor, and she died. And David went in great detail about why he, from what he understands, why he thinks she was killed by the chiropractor from the neck manipulation. And so he just kind of forgot about it. And this woman is actually one of my friends out here who signed you up for your tickets. Mike, well, went to high school, elementary school with this girl. He knew her, he knows her family. So you know, this is a real sad, anytime somebody dies before their time, it's sad, but this is just some, you know, it's a personal thing, because he knows her, and knows her family, and, you know, they play house together, I don't know. But anyway, so it's very sad, but the coroner's report came out a few days ago, and the coroner's report said she died from manipulation of her neck. She had a stroke. So her Wikipedia page, I said, again, we're sharing it in social media. Awesome, we're sharing it amongst our group, but that doesn't help anything get beyond the choir. How are we gonna educate the world if we're just talking to each other, right? Maybe you're educating your next door neighbor, maybe you're educating some friend of yours from high school, but we're not hitting the big numbers we have. So my first instinct is, what does Wikipedia say? So I went over to her Wikipedia page, this took me 15 minutes of doing that, and it says her cause of death was stroke. And that's in that little info box. So I changed it. I said stroke resulting from chiropractic manipulation. And the chiropractic manipulation is a hyperlink so they can click on that. Because most people, believe it or not, do not understand that chiropractic is not really a doctor, right? And, okay? So, and then you can see here I have a citation. I just put that in there. So if somebody was interested, you could go back and you could see that David Gorski wrote this article, and it has the great detail because he had photos of how the neck was bent, and he had it in great detail so somebody could get some great information if they're interested in this horrible thing that happened. And I don't know if you can see here, but I don't have my little pointy thing. This is something else I train people to do in GSOW. This is called an author link, and it makes the citation live. This is a trademark of my team, is we're trying to, everything we can think of to make it everywhere on the Wikipedia some place where people can find more information, and maybe somebody will say, oh, David Gorski, who's that? They can click on that, and it'll go right to his Wikipedia page. And we do that constantly throughout Wikipedia, because that's how I train. Here's her views. Oh, you can see this. This is her views on the days that the media was interested in what was going on with her. And she normally received 60 views a day. But the day that the media got the coroner's report, 10,000 views saw what I wrote. 13,000 views the next day, 12,000 the next day, 5,000 the next day, and 3,000 the next day. So this is just a way of saying to people, look, this is serious stuff. I didn't look, but I probably could have looked and saw if David Gorski's Wikipedia views went up that day too, and I would assume they did. But sometimes it's kind of hard to tell because David Gorski's, you know, putting out blogs all the time, and I'm sure his stats are going all over the place. It's hard to tell if there's a huge spike on one day. So, in conclusion, doing skeptical activism is much easier with other people, and thus the GSOW project. If you're interested in joining my GSOW team, I want you to join. I have a little table room that's going to be over here behind registration, the GSOW room. CSI has very graciously given me this area that I will have laptops. I'm going to spend almost my majority of my time there sitting down with you. If you want to even know anything about Wikipedia, if you've ever had a question about Wikipedia, if you want to know anything, I will happily sit down and talk to you about it hands-on. We will pull up pages and look at it together. It's so much better when we do this together. We have your wiki back, and it's important that we all have people's wiki backs, because if we as a community do not have these Wikipedia pages, nobody's going to do it. They can't write these. There's nobody out there writing these Wikipedia pages for people unless we do it. And how can we expect these people to be respected if we don't respect our people? This is our responsibility. If that page is crap, it is our fault. And I'm not just talking to GSOW, I'm talking about, you know, our community. We should have this. We should be proactive. If I had known about the cupping therapy page in advance, well, heck, I could have taken care of it. This man here has a Cosmos shirt. Maybe you think about Cosmos. Before Cosmos came out, we knew it was coming out. We went in and did everything we possibly could for Cosmos, related in many languages, so that when Neil deGrasse Tyson had that first episode, bam, the Wikipedia stats were like out the roof, and we were there. We had it all done. Another man over here has a Nexus shirt on. I wrote the Wikipedia page for Nexus in time for Nexus to come out. Same with Perry DeAngelis. I wrote that Wikipedia page so that when the media hits and people are going, what's this Nexus? They Google it. There it is. And anybody who didn't really already know, this, one of my editors, like 2 days ago, wrote a Wikipedia page for this conference. So if you look at SciCon on Wikipedia, there it is. And there's a nice picture of Barry Carr, who's been so awesome at organizing this, and a link to his page, because I wrote that years ago. And there's a picture of him with the podium at the CFI, and I tweeted at him the other night, and at 4 a.m, he responded, him and Trump, I guess, you know. But he responded, and I'm like, why are you responding, you know? I just was telling him, and he wrote back, and I said, did you see the link saying that CFI has, CSI has a Wikipedia page? And I mean, SciCon has a Wikipedia page now. He goes, well, now I know what tie not to wear. Because he's looking at the picture of himself with the tie. He goes, I'm not wearing that tie. This is here. And you need to do it, just like Stephanie said. Now, I have one more thing that Stephanie and I talked about, because not everybody here is going to leave here and want to go out and edit Wikipedia. When you go through training with me, it is intense. I am going to train you. It takes as long as you want. But I do the training, and I will intensely train you. You will come out of this knowing, oh my gosh, you will be so good. But I want to just do one thing for something you could do right now, today, now. And I suppose I should hit something under here.
Present.
Oh, there you go. Okay, so what can you do now? You all can do this now. I've got like 10 slides. Web of Trust, absolutely amazing product that has been out for a few years. I think this is a Google Chrome only, but Web of Trust is the perfect place to download. It's a plugin you add to your computer. If you have a person in your family who tends to go to these woo sites, you know, and kind of believes everything they find on the internet, what you need to do is take their computer from them and you say, Betty Bay, my, or you know, whatever her name or his name is, and you say, I have this virus protecting thing from you. This is gonna help you out a lot. I'm gonna add this little plugin to your computer. And if you ever see these little red circles next to a URL, don't go there. That's dangerous. It's gonna hurt your computer. If you have to lie and say that, do it. Because it'll keep them away from those websites that you know they're not quite adept at looking at the critical thinking. And they're not gonna do knowing different. This is used millions of times. And Web of Trust looks like this. Here's a Brzezinski clinic.
Oh.
We've been all over this Wikipedia page. He hates me, by the way. I am endorsed by David Gore, Deepak Chopra hates me, Rupert Sheldrick hates me, Brzezinski clinic, Natural News hates me. Oh. Anything that happens on Wikipedia that the paranormal world happens, they blame me whether I've touched it or not, or if I just said other people have not touched it. We get blamed for it, it's wonderful. It makes a reputation of me. But if you look at the Brzezinski Clinic page, if you just Google Brzezinski Clinic, you see all these red dots. These are people who have a plug-in, the Web of Trust. So I will happily show you how to plug this in. I will happily show you how to rate a page. All you do is you go to Wikipedia, a website, and you're hitting, is it trustworthy, is it not trustworthy? And Stephanie's example she gave earlier, if he hadn't taken his website down, it would have been red, 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 this is not trustworthy, this is not trustworthy, this is not trustworthy. So the people won't go there. And you can see, here's Bob Blaskowitz, is the other Brzezinski patient group. I love Bob Blaskowitz, I wish he was here. But he's an amazing person as well, but he's done a lot. So you Google the word Brzezinski Clinic, the Wikipedia page is like the third view. And all these red dots are where you don't go. The yellow ones mean that they're in transition. We need to rate them more so we can get that change so it is red. Here's what you would see if you went to the Wikipedia page, the website for someplace like Brzezinski. It comes up with this big blocking thing that says, this has been rated, don't go here, it's not safe, it's not trustworthy. So we want people all over the world who are trying to find information to see this, and they will most likely go, oh geez, this is going to give me spam on my computer, this is going to do something awful, I know it's awful, and then they leave. They don't go to the website because we've warned them, don't go there. You could click through and you can go in and won't harm your computer, probably. Here's another thing that we would like people to do. I am on Skepticality. I hope you guys all have are listening to Skepticality. I've been on it for a couple years. I do a segment on there. I absolutely love it. We get hundreds of thousands of downloads for each of our episodes. And this is where we get the most of our editors from, Skepticality. But what we would ask you to do is please go and rate podcasts you listen to on iTunes or where Stitcher or wherever else you do. Because if you rate them, if you give them a 5 stars and you leave a comment, what happens is they go up in the ratings, and then people outside of our choir are just coming into skepticism, finding it for the first time, they're more likely to find our podcasts because you've rated them and it's moved them up in the rankings, and it's going to make more. As Stephanie said, we're growing our community, we're making new skeptics. A lot of people came for podcasts, right? Joanne's people here? Yes. I mean, I've never heard of skepticism, but a lot of people have until you heard a podcast. Here is, this is a Amazon. You can donate money through Amazon just by making it out, just an actual purchase. And
it's called Amazon Smile.
Amazon Smiles, here it is. I've given 9 cents to the Barry Skeptics. Obviously, I don't shop very much with Amazon. But you can see they've already given $32 million from Amazon, and it doesn't cost you anything. All you gotta do is just say, I want this charity. So this is an easy way to give money to a charity. This is Amazon book reviews. Please review a book from somebody in our community. Give them 5 stars, link to it, write us something. Our editor, our writers, the people who write these books, they care. They go and they read this stuff. They get a lot of feedback from it. And again, it brings the rankings up and it makes our books look just that much more, you know? If you go and you look at the book and nobody's rated it, they're going, oh, yeah, maybe I don't want to buy this book. But if it's got lots of great reviews on it, I mean, only rate it if you like it, okay? But for the most part, please rate a podcast and that. Here's another one, Patreon. Please donate. Please donate to your people who are doing the videos, who are doing the conferences, who are doing the work. The $2 a month, I mean, it's really nothing. It comes out of your PayPal, it comes out of there. And it really does make a huge difference because we're such a tiny community. And we, you know, $300 or $400 a month to some of these people who are still starting out with podcasts really can not only improve the quality of the podcast, but it makes them feel loved and they want to do this again because nobody's getting rich off of this. And lastly, Facebook. This is an insight group for, I have a GSOW Facebook group. And a lot of people don't really understand. Let's say we have 1,000 people who've liked my Facebook group. When I make a post on here, not all 1,000 people get it in their feed. They're only gonna get it in their feed based on how popular my site is. So to think of it this way, if you like a post, it gets 1 point. If you comment on the post, it gets 10 points. If you share a post, it gets 25 points. That's just a generic thing I'm just kind of made up. So what it's saying is if you are doing these things to a website, a Facebook group, then that makes the ranking, the algorithms with Facebook boost the posts. So if they have people, you know, sharing and stuff like that, when I make another post on the Facebook page group, then it boosts it. It goes out to more of the people who are following my page. I hope that made a little sense. I'm not sure it did. But in other words, this is something you can do by liking, sharing, and commenting on pages on Facebook. It actually does promote us a little bit further than you would think. So, and again, please, if you want to know anything about Wikipedia, there's a lot of things that need to be done. I have 70 more or less editors that are on my team. I cannot be everywhere. And if you come to me and you say, you should be working on this page, I'm going to say, when do you start? Because you will start, and we will start working on the page right away. Okay, so Stephanie and I have some time. Stephanie, why don't you come back up here? Let's take some questions. Do we have a microphone, or how do you guys want to do this? Do you want to shout things out at us and throw them to
you? Just yell at us, it's fine.
Somebody's gonna have a question.
I've got a question actually for Stephanie's lawyer.
he's not up here.
Yeah, no, fair enough, but it deals with costs. And I'm just curious, I'm a lawyer in Alberta, and if you bring a frivolous claim, the court has the ability to award costs against the plaintiff, up to what we call solicitor claim. So every penny that she had to pay you, you get back. Do you have those same type of cost ramifications?
Largely speaking, that is un-American. Yes. in our court system, we refer to it as the American rule, is that all parties bear their own costs. So unless there is a statute, a specific statute, or a contractual obligation to shift costs, we do it the American way. The other rule is called, it doesn't have a name, so it's a un-American. We're going to build a wall to keep that rule out. But in some states, we have what's known as an anti-slap law for cases like this.
Not in Arizona.
Not in Arizona, no. We have the first one was passed in California. The strongest one in the country is here in Nevada. I'm very proud of that because I wrote it. But it also in our Copyright Act, we have a fee shifting as well. So you gotta be very specific about the claim. So generally, if you think you might get sued here, try to make sure you get sued in Nevada or California.
We went through that actually. We were trying to get the case because Adam had various locations. I think he had hit various properties in these states. We were trying to get the case moved either to California or here in Nevada. We were hoping for Nevada, obviously, because the law is much stronger. I was sad that we couldn't get it. For whatever, I don't remember what the reason was, we didn't move it, but I was really sad because that would have ended the case immediately.
Well, the fear of that was part of why they turned the tail.
Exactly.
Yeah. Right, you had a question?
Oh, yeah. You were talking about upranking skeptical podcasts. The flip side of that, and downranking pseudoscience podcasts.
Well, that's, if you have the time, that's fine, but. We're just asking you to be the bigger person and just go in and push ours up a little bit. But if you want to write them down, I'm not going to say no. But yeah, there's only so much time in the world. Let's get ours all done first.
My approach would be just to be positive in general.
Oh, for the questions. Who wants to ask a question?
My approach is to just be more positive in general than what I do more on the level. It's pretty negative, a lot of other stuff. But that's just me. Like she said, you do go for it.
We have a question from the Czech Republic.
Hi, Stephanie. Hi. Is there anyone you're currently pursuing or anyone who's currently pursuing you?
That's a loaded question. It has two meanings. So I'll go with
the one.
I'm not dating anybody. I actually have someone in mind, but I haven't made a video in a while for reasons you can come ask me about later outside. But there's a couple of people. The Long Island Medium.
Yeah! Take her down.
Someone I want to go after. I alerted Mark to this incidentally. He said, you know, the next person I'm gonna go after is this person. Is that cool with you?
You're not going after a person. You're reporting on facts and scientific.
We need more lawyers.
That's true. That's true. But I actually, now that I have this reputation, I have to pick my targets. So in that case.
You can also go congressional here.
But no, I'm thinking about going after the Long Island Medium, and then there's this guy, this faith healer, he's about 25, and he works basically in the Northeast, doing essentially what Adam did, though his is a little more, let's find God to give you miracles, which isn't far from faith healing as far as I'm concerned, so I'm going after that as soon as I can get to it.
Grief vampires are like, you just, don't go there with me. Psychics are just like my thing. And if you Google, and I was going to do this, but it was too long, I have done a lot of stings with using Wikipedia and other elements for several different psychics. One is Chip Coffey and a couple others. And I just recently have been taking on a new psychic out there. It's called Hollywood Medium. He's called Tyler Henry. And if you Google these phrases, Susan Gerbic and Psychic, you're gonna, or go to the Wikipedia page of Susan Gerbic, you will see all the different operations I've done. One is called Operation Bumblebee, the next one is Operation Ice Cream Cone, and the next one is Operation Tater Tot. And you'll see that we have just, oh, I love going after psychics. Psychics are just, they're like my,
Now you can see why they put us together.
Yeah, oh boy. So if you Google those, you'll see an eyeful, it will just, what we've done. Who else has questions?
Oh, wait a second, you see that. Let's turn this thing on.
Give the mic to Bertha, this can only end well. He made enough to have houses in three states, or at least property in three states.
Wow.
He was a former Olympian and got hurt. So of course, instead of finding a trade that matters, he decided to, you know, promote nonsense. So it was the easiest thing. I also noticed that he didn't have much in the way of formal higher education, which is also like, oh, he didn't want to go back to school. I get it. His reach was probably more local. But I'm not really concerned about how many people he harms. If he harms one person, it's too many as far as I'm concerned.
He doesn't have a Wikipedia page either.
He has one on Rational Wiki. Which is funny because I didn't do it. Someone else did. But yeah, he didn't have a lot of reach. As far as I knew, most of, I would have to say that most of the notoriety he got was negative after suing me. But yeah, he did have clients. In fact, in one of his response videos, he had his clients sitting there telling me that I was wrong, despite the fact that the plural of anecdote is not data. So, yeah, it wasn't that big a deal as far as his reach, but that doesn't factor into who I not go after, but explain why they're wrong. Thank you, Mark. Who's next?
Susan, could you please comment on the position that homeopathy followers or homeopathy enthusiasts are now doing against Wikipedia?
Oh, that's a couple years old, but actually they petitioned, the energy healer people went after Jimmy Wells, who's the person who made Wikipedia, and he basically told them, you know, get a life, we're not going to do a change.org to change Wikipedia, which is what they wanted to do. But homeopathy is a page that in the last couple of years they've been really trying, they put out a change.org thing to give to Wikipedia, saying, let us have our opinion on Wikipedia. And it went like nowhere. Who would you give it to? Wikipedia is not a thing. I mean, it's not like a person. Yeah, what are you going to do? Email wikipedia.org? And just, no. So homeopathy is a very well-written Wikipedia page. You can read the lead of it. The word quackery is in there. The word pseudoscience. It's an amazing Wikipedia page, a homeopathy page. And we really didn't have much to do with it.
I see a question coming.
Thank you. And so I'm glad you had a good experience with regards to your legal suit.
Yeah. I don't think the guy next to you was not my idea. That was all happening.
So I've been sued four times. I'm for standing up basically for the safety of accidents. And if it's for a sentence in a book that I've written, then the publisher basically covers that, so that's good. But if it's not, if for example, it's a quote that I have in a magazine, then I'm on my own. Unfortunately, I'm in a financial position where I can afford to do that, but it's expensive, very expensive. And it does work. I can tell you that in my world, in the world of fighting the anti-vaccine forces, there are a lot of people who don't get into it because they see what happens. They see what these lawsuits do. The purpose of suing you, as you say, is not to win, it's to shut you up. And it works. And similarly, when you write books, you know, your books are gone over with a fine-tooth comb by the lawyers to make sure you're not saying anything that's dishonest. So it is. It's a terrible situation. Usually when I'm sued, the other side, you know, does not pay for that lawsuit. And even when you win, you know, you lose because you're paying tens of thousands of dollars for your lawyer. It's a terrible situation in America. The American rule is bad, although I've been sued in England, and that's worse. Because there,
I don't ever want to be sued in England. Oh my goodness. I have facts, we don't care.
No, in England, it's kind of, Simon Singh actually was sort of a breakthrough moment in England. But, you know, there's not a First Amendment. In England, I was sued for something that in America would have never been lawsuit, and so it was not a success. But I ended up settling for a minute. But it's a terrible situation, I think, that the law the way it is.
Yeah.
It's intimidating and it works.
Not against me.
If you get sued outside of the United States and you don't have anything they can take from you there, you can pretty much tell them to shut up their ass. because we have a new law. Luckily, somebody sued over an allegation somebody was connected to Al Qaeda, so racism really helped us this time. It's not always bad. There's been a lawsuit against the royal family, that probably would have been Congress cheering for it. But Peter King, of all people, pushed the Speech Act through. So if you sued outside the US for defamation and didn't get all the protections the First Amendment would give you there, which you're not going to get that in London or, you know, Brazzaville or wherever. So if that happens and then they try to enforce it in the US, not only would it not be enforceable, you get your fees from them. There's been a lot of people who have solved live tourism who then go, oh shit, when they try to enforce it in the US. So it can be kind of fun to try to goad somebody into suing you outside of the US, run that game a few times, and then say, oh, now you're in the swamp and you're acting out.
Too bad Sylvia Brown's not with us anymore.
But if you do get sued in England, ask the Good Thinking Society. They are promoting anti-homophobia, anti-vaxxers, a very huge movement in England. They actually lowered the National Health Service budget for homeopathy. So they do amazing work, and they have a lot of lawyers, and they're very, very successful. So if you get sued in England, just email the Good Thinking Society.
Okay. Good questions. Next question.
Yeah, so my question is more related to, you know, sharing things on Facebook and you getting the word out. So a lot of times when I do share stuff like Katie Day's death, I'll get responses from friends that will be along the lines of, yeah, but here's a post about someone who was, you know, injured in, you know, quote, Western medicine. And like a lot of times it's like a vaccine injury, like natural news type links, but sometimes it is, you know, it looks like doctor malpractice. I'm wondering what sort of either of you, like your suggestions for how to combat that without sort of getting them to like double down on their sort of pseudoscience?
That's a great question. What I tell people is I don't attack them. I try to make them think a little bit themselves, because we know, especially with Wikipedia, people are not, if you try to shove it down the throat, the answer, they're not going to take it. They're going to circle the cognitive dissonance wagon, and they're going to double down, triple down, whatever. So you need to let them try to do a little research and kind of give them some ideas about, really, well, if that's true, then what, you know, I don't really know. You're trying to get them to do some research and to do a little thinking themselves. If you can get them to do some research, they're more likely to accept it because they did it. They're saving face. They're saying, you know, now that I did some research on this homeopathy thing, I don't think it's quite right. They're going to Wikipedia. They're not going to tell you they went to Wikipedia because Wikipedia has got that reputation as being, you know, not right. But they're going to get, like, if your coworker is saying, hey, I even had this back problem or whatever, or gastro, try this stuff. And you're like, this guy's kind of weird. And you start looking into it. Homeopathy sounds kind of natural. I can try it. You go and you look into it, they come to work the next day, they're like, you know, I'm not quite, you know, I think I'm going to go to my regular GP, I'm not really, because that's where they're finding their information. So if you can not attack them, but kind of just think it through. I met a man the other day and mentioned spontaneous human combustion, which is like something that scared the crap out of me as a child, and we wrote the Wikipedia page because that's who was speaking with Joe Nickel, who's written a lot about spontaneous human combustion. And I met a man and I said something, I used that as an example because it's kind of funny. He says, well, what about it? I said, yeah, what about it? He says, well, don't people burst into flames? I said, well, you know, if that was true, think of a football stadium. How many people there maybe would be bursting into flames in a big football stadium? Have you ever heard anybody do that? Who doesn't have a Samsung? But I mean, have you ever heard of somebody bursting into flames and they're walking down the street at the grocery store and they think, no? And I'm like, well, you know. You know, you try to, that's how I would approach it. It's just like, don't attack them.
Susan's a little nicer than me. I'm going to just quickly answer her question because I'm not nearly as nice as she is. If that was on Facebook, I would probably say something along the lines of, yes, but doctors have laws against harming people. And when they do commit malpractice, 99 times out of 100 they take to court and sue for lots of money. Doctors are required to keep malpractice insurance for those very things. The difference between science and pseudoscience is science corrects its mistakes. And so yes, mistakes are going to be made. Science is coming to you and saying, they don't, cancer patients, for instance, they'll come and say, look, this has an 80% chance or 70% chance of working, right? You may be in that 30%, that 20%. If that's the case, then they're telling you up front, this might not work, right? They're being honest. Where pseudoscientists, on the other hand, will say, no, this works all the time for everything, always, it never fails, right? That's the difference. And I try to point that out, like, who's being more honest here about what they're doing? I like honesty, and I find science in general to be far more honest. So, okay, yes, there are bad doctors, there are bad people, but science and medicine on its own are not evil. They promote correction and learning, and the thing that they're railing against doesn't. And if it's an anti-vaccine, the likelihood that there's a vaccine injury is, what's that word, zero? Yes. All right, excellent.
Thank you for trying to make some money for Opportunity Village. Can you tell the people who don't know what they do?
Yes. So if you guys don't know what Opportunity Village is, I will tell you. I actually learned about it from Penn, Gillette, who's kind of, sort of famous in this town. He is a silent partner who follows him around everywhere. Nice guy. He's donated money to Opportunity Village a lot in the past, and when the lawsuit came up, I was like, well, you know, I want to do some good. If I end up with excess money, say, I get more money than Mark wanted. He's a lawyer, so that's not going to happen. But assuming it happens, I was going to donate the rest of it to Opportunity Village, which I think we did 1,000, I think it was, that ended up being the overage there. Yeah, it was about $1,000 that I saved to Opportunity Village. They are a charity that helps the mentally disadvantaged and handicapped, whatever PC word I'm supposed to use for that. It helps them integrate into society better, helps them find jobs, really helps them live in society in an integrated way instead of being otherwise. And I love that they do that. My uncle, who's in his upper 70s, has Down syndrome, so it's been kind of close to my heart, and that's kind of why. Thank you for making me
extend
that. Appreciate it.
Bye, Jenny.
Thank you, Stephanie. What you just said and what's been said by some of the people in the room, like Paul, about the problem of having to deal with our American system of justice reminds me of the line from the movie The Right Stuff. If you recall, there's a line where one of the astronauts says to the actor playing Werner von Braun, no Bucks, no Buck Rogers. The skeptical movement or activism, as we discuss it, skeptical activism, that's why we're here today, is a relatively small group of people internationally, unfortunately. And one of the problems is that we need Bucks. We don't have enough to finance something like a legal defense fund, which would be a solution to some of these problems. States, how great would it be if we had someone like the number one donor of the JREF, James Randi Educational Foundation, whose money allowed that foundation to exist and flourish. And when he retreated, the foundation essentially disappeared. We don't have those kind of wealthy donors. We need more of them, and we need a strategic plan for the entire skeptics movement. It's not going to be a strategic plan that's going to be developed in this room and a workshop, but it's something that the few organizations, I'm involved in three of them, have to get together on, create a steering committee, and develop a strategic plan for the skeptical movement, to the extent that it's a movement. Trying to get skeptics together for something like this is kind of like the old saying, the anarchist convention. It couldn't be anybody would come to the anarchist convention. We're kind of like that kind of group. But we have our educational portion, we have our legal portion, and we have our grassroots portion. And we've got to get those all working together. So pardon me for my sermonizing for 30 seconds, but to me, that's part of what we were here for. Skeptical activism means we have to develop a strategic plan and get all the organizations to work together with that.
I mean, you say you can't come up with an idea to come up with a pyramid, but if everyone here just starts one pyramid scheme, get all your friends to do it, we'll We'll have money in no time. Yes, Mark.
If I can just talk as the person who would be the one doing the fighting a lot of times, I've been in this situation. I think if you have, anytime I deal with somebody who's an activist who has a steering committee and an organization, and they say, well, we can go to them, I say, don't freaking bother. Right? I don't care what it is. But in your case, and in a number of other cases that I have worked on, what has worked immensely well is crowdfunding. Because it does two things. Right? First of all, one of you gets sued for this, you're all getting sued. And if one of you says it's not my fucking problem, you're the fucking problem. I don't care if you're $5, pitch it in. When somebody gets sued, you need to put the word out. Because it's better, I think it's better getting a pile of donations rather than one person saying, I'll stroke the check. I've gotten that before. Some benefactor calls us and says, here's $100,000, fight this out. Believe me, it's music to my ears. But I'd rather get 20,000 in small donations because then I show the clients. You just opened up a can of whoop ass that is not only going to fund this, she's not feeling the pain while you feel the pain, and these people cared enough to give money. And then if every one of them goes up and gets five people to give money, I'm going to bury you in publicity and money. So go get your fucking shine box. It's pretty much a conversation.
Like I said, pyramid scheme, it works best.
And it's done. So, I mean, the idea is outstanding. Everybody, I am Spartacus. You don't have to go watch the fucking movie. That's how you do it.
I do appreciate Susan saying that it was brave. I mean, I guess in a way it is, because, you know, there's this huge legal thing. But honestly, I really did laugh when I got served. I legitimately stood there in my apartment alone and laughed. My dog thought it was crazy. As much as they could think. I mean, I was scared, mostly because I didn't know how I was going to afford a lawyer. But as I said during my talk, you guys were the reason I succeeded, just to his point. If it wasn't for the crowdfunding, if it wasn't for the publicity, if it wasn't for any of that, likelihood is I probably would have shrunk and taken my videos down because I don't want to deal with a lawsuit. But I was like, when I was thinking about it, I was like, you know, I've been doing a lot of scamming conferences. I know these people. They got my back. And as long as I'm doing things right and basing things on facts, they will be behind me. And you guys were. To the tune of $25,000, $26,000. Like Mark was talking about, that can speak so much more to what's going on. Because it shows them that there's a lot of people that they support you, willing to give money, as he said, but also that your numbers are bigger than them. Right? Because they think they have all this faith community behind them. Faith community is pretty fractured. We know, right? 38,000 or so sects of Christianity, I think it was, somewhere in the 30s. So I know that you guys aren't alone, I guess. It can be scary being sued, but you're not alone, I promise. I'll help you.
Okay, I had a question about advice about getting past the, what I would call the one-line disclaimer. And I'm thinking about a situation, I'm from Long Island, and last year we had a situation where one of our local taxpayer-supported libraries was sponsoring and publicized that they were sponsoring a meet the psychic night. Two of our local organizations, one is the local Long Island chapter of CFI, the other is Long Island Humanist, got together and drafted a letter to the library saying this is pseudoscience and you're supported by taxpayer money and you're promoting pseudoscience. And the answer from the person at the library who had organized the evening was, it's not promotional because we're not charging anybody to come there, and it's considered entertainment. Like, previously we had a local comedian come, for a meet the comedian evening, and that was entertainment, and this is entertainment. It's not being promoted as anything other than that. And we were, our answer was kind of like, schmuck. The psychic is doing it for free because they're promoting themselves and people are going to come there and be caught up in the cold reading and say, how did she possibly know that? And then they're going to schedule a session, which is why they're doing this. And what we did get was we got one head of our CFI chapter at the time was interviewed by News 12 about this. Give a 20-minute interview and they put one line on it at like 3 o'clock in the afternoon.
Of course.
But the evening went ahead, and the library never threw back down what they were doing.
So what I heard was how you get past that this is only for entertainment disclaimer. That's a funny story. Because remember when I was talking earlier about how I did a video about how Adam changed his website? One of the things he added after I pointed a lot of stuff out is he added a line that says, this is for entertainment purposes only, thinking, this will make things better, not with me around, at least, because I noticed it, and noticed that difference, and I pointed out in that video, I said, isn't it funny how he went from, no, I can cure your stuff, to this is entertainment only? Does it sound like a healer to me if it's for entertainment purposes? Anyone gone to a hospital for the fun of it? No? Surprising. It's silly. It's hard to get around. Adam did something for me in the sense that he didn't have another thing he did. But if they're going to claim that it's for entertainment purposes only, I go, cool, so then why are you taking people's money to talk to their dead relatives? That doesn't sound like very entertaining to me. That sounds very sad to me.
This is another thing that I just don't have time to do, but if somebody wanted to take it on, we were looking into it. A lot of cities have these rules that say if you are going to be an entertainment thing, then you have to have special permits and you have to pay fines and fees. So like if you have an amusement park or if you have a circus coming to town, they have to pay extra fees. And if a psychic or somebody says it's for entertainment only, they're supposed to fill out a permit and pay the fees for their entertainment thing. So, I mean, you could force that through if you wanted to take the time to do it. And there's all kinds of ordinances all over the place, and they're just ignored for psychics, but, oh yeah, we could take them big time.
Piggybacking on that, do you know what the punishment is for a chiropractor that kills somebody? Not much is right. I was looking at quackwatch.org looking at a few, and one story stuck out to me. I don't know if you've seen this one. Someone had died, very similar to how Katie Mae died. The chiropractor didn't lose his license. He still practices. He had to pay a $1,000 fine. So basically, because it's pseudoscience, this person's life now is worth $1,000 instead of what happens to doctors who are covered by lots of laws. And they go through 8 years of school. It's not fun to become a doctor. I have some friends that are doing it. It's very, very difficult. So what you're saying to the general public is, if you go with woo and you get killed, you're on your own. But if it happens in a scientific institution, we'll destroy them. That's not a good real message. That's not a really good message to send. And I wish that we had better laws regarding that stuff.
When I did the Operation Tater Tot, Ice Cream Cone and Operation Bumblebee, I did crowdsource on Facebook, and I needed $2,000 to do those projects, and I had it within 24 hours. People were so generous, and they didn't even know what I was doing. They said, I'm going after a psychic who's with me, and they were just like, yeah, let's get him, Susan. And we did, and it was amazing. But I, just like Jay says, I really do think that I've been in the skepticism world for 20 years or so, maybe not quite that much, but that's what I'm at now. But I really do think we need to really think this over. We've got to come up with some better ideas. We've got to regroup after all the drama that we just came through and heal. And let's get our priorities straight. Let's get going. And anything that's planned, I want to be in on it. Anybody have questions? Are we close to time to meet? Because I'm starving. Anybody wants to come eat with us? You're welcome to come and hang out with me.
Yes, we'll be.
And I'm going to have my booth over here down here. Like I said, I probably won't be going to any of the lectures. I will be available to you all to spend as much time as you need to learn whatever you want to learn and we'll answer whatever questions and make up something if I don't know.
Cool. Thanks, everyone, for coming. Appreciate it.